So what I will present is the results for the second data release on the variability analysis and processing of the Gaia data. Gaia is doing a systematic census of celestial objects brighter than a certain limit. And Gaia is multi-epoch. So for every object it observes, it has several measurements, as a mean 70 measurements over the 5 years. Gaia produces also precision astrometry. Gaia observes the entire sky with a single set of instruments. Gaia takes nearly simultaneously measurements in these different instruments for the astrometry, the photometry in G, BP, and RP integrated, in spectrophotometry in BP, RP, and for the radial velocity instrument, RVS. So all these measurements are useful when variable stars are studied. And by doing this census, a colleague was saying that Gaia is a kind of NSA of the galaxy. We see that there is a real zoo of objects. The objects are varying for very different physical reasons. In the data releases, there is an iterative approach. There was in the September 2016, the first data release where we used the G-band photometry. It was only for a little region of the sky at South Ecliptic Pole covering the LMC. We output 3,000 stars that Cepheid and Harari rays. It was like a showcase. It was just demonstrating that the stars, the photometry, Gaia is functioning very well respective to the photometric calibration and pipeline. So globally, what we covered, that's the little yellow box there in the variability tree, just a small region of this variability tree and for a small region of the sky. For the DR2, then we are not using the G-band photometry, but also the BP-RP integrated photometry. We are also using a preliminary version of the astrometry. And we go to the entire sky, and we have more than 500,000 stars. And we also expand the number of objects we classify. Delta Scuti S6 Phoenici stars, Cepheid, Harari Ray, PY Draconis stars, long period variables. And also, we explored short time scale variability. In this data release, Gaia already produces among the largest catalogs of variable stars published. In fact, I think that's the largest catalog which covers really the entire sky, because globally, usually the different telescopes which are on Earth, they observe only a fraction of the sky. So for the data release 2, we cover more box. We see that it's still quite small. We have LPVs, Cepheid, Harari rays, S6 Phoenici Delta Scuti stars and BY Draconis stars. Now, if we look at the sky coverage for the DR2, it's taking 22 months. And obviously, when you want to study variable stars, you need to have many measurements. And this is a map of the two field of view transits. The more you have measurements, the better it is. So now if we go to 12, we see that some regions are less well covered. We have the bulge region, which is covered, which is complete at 67%, and the ecliptic poles at of the galaxy at 26%. Now, if we go to 20 field of view transits, then we see that we have the footprint of the scanning law. There are regions where there is no stars observed with 20 field of view of transits. And so that means, for example, in the galactic bulge, only 14% of the stars are covered with this number of measurements. Obviously, with the time going on, we will have a more uniform covering of the sky. So in this variability processing, we analyze 22 months of G, GBP, GRP field of view transit time series. And we have globally 119 billion measurements that we analyzed. So it's enormous. And we used, as said, the preliminary astrometric solution. So we had a two path here. We used two way of performing the classification, one with only at least two field of view transit and one with 20 field of view transit. So the side of 20 field of view of transit is covering the whole sky, and it's two is the minimal to have multi-epoch data. Then after the classification, we transmitted the data to people who analyzed specific classes. So they are the Cepheida Narrarire, which were processed and analyzed by Italian groups in Bologna and Naples. There is long period variables analyzed by a group in Vienna, and the rotation modulation also in Italy, in Catania. So this shows this aspect of Gaia, which is a large collaboration of people, and we are looking in these specific objects studies on specialists of certain variability types. The classification was also done by several teams, by Leuven University and also UNED in Madrid. So if we look at the results about the numbers, we have about 8,000 Delta Scuti stars, S6 Phenisti stars, 10,000 Cepheid, 240,000 Arar Lyrae stars, 145,000 BY Draconis stars, 150,000 long period variables, and 3,000 short time scale variability phenomena. So these catalogs in the literature are among the largest known. If you look at the light curves that we obtain, we have on the left panel the time series in Julian date, and we have the three bands, RP in red, G band photometry in black, and BP in blue. And on the right, you have the folded curves in the different bands where we the range has been conserved in the different plot, so that we see that typical variable stars, pulsating variables like we show here, an Arar Lyrae, Cepheid, anomalous Cepheid, and a long period variable, we see that the amplitude in B is larger than in G and larger in R. So this is an unprecedented description of variables in these large number and in such bands. So now if you do a map of the on the sky of all the class that are detected, you see this map and you see already some features. For example, you have a little finger going out of the bulge, which is the Sagittarius, and you have a band above, which is the Sagittarius stream. It is appearing. So globally, these are more the Arar Lyrae, which are tracing this Sagittarius stream. So thanks also to the astrometry, what we can do is to take the literature and put that in the color magnitude diagram. And there you have the different type that are located in the HR diagram. You can see Cepheid, Arar Lyrae, Gamma Doradus stars. You can see also pulsating white dwarfs. And you see that in the diagram, these groups are located. So that will provide for the community an analysis to see if the prediction of the pulsating model are fitting the observations. So this diagram is also, with this variety, is also unprecedented. We can do also motions in the color magnitude diagram. Thanks to the GBP and RP, we can see how objects are moving around. So I was thinking that it is looking a bit like a painting of Pollock. Here is the color magnitude diagram, and you have the different variables. So every kind of little loop is an object. So what you see is that pulsating stars, long period variable, Cepheid, Arar Lyrae, Delta Scuti stars, they are bluer when they are brighter. So they are moving in a diagonal, high left up. If you look at the other physical phenomena like BE stars, gamma Cassiopeia stars, eruptive phenomena, there you see that the motion is in the opposite direction. It's when brighter in G, it's getting redder. And you see below that set of eclipsing binaries where the variability is also a bit more like the pulsating, but more vertical. And you have also there the amplitudes are relatively small, AP stars, where the motion is more horizontal or even in a direction a bit like the gamma Cassiopeia stars. So this description is also unprecedented with such a large number of stars. So what we see is that it is just the beginning. And so the DR2, with his already enormous catalog, is just the tip of the iceberg of Gaia variable analysis. And so there, in the following data release, we will not only use BP, RP, G photometry, but the spectrophotometry. We will also use the astrometry and the RBS instrument. And that will go the entire sky with enough measurement everywhere. And so we will have probably many, many millions variable objects, stars or QSO.